Community activists and managers at the Port Newark at the seaport for the Barack administration. These young men have held one of the first demonstrations ever at the seaport in Newark, New Jersey this past week. So we'd like to welcome them with a round of applause. And I'm gonna let these gentlemen introduce themselves and give you their bio and a brief history about themselves. Up first is none other than Alturrick Kenney.
Good evening, audience, and thank you, Alex Awal, for bringing us a part of this important conversation. My name is Alturrick Kenney. My title is Manager of Port Activities for the City of Newark, New Jersey. I'm a lifelong Newark resident here in the City of Newark, proud graduate of Weekway High School, which prepared me from Howard University, and also attend graduate school at George Washington University here, well, in Foggy Bottom, Washington, D.C. And so I've had a number of years of experience working in government, from being an elected school board member to now working under the Barack administration to make sure that we try to not only get jobs for Newark residents, but also talk about the issues that impact in our environment, from the gas emissions that come off of the trucks, the ships, as well as look at relocating businesses from off the port into Newark, into the city of Newark, so we can get more ratables for our residents. So that's what I do in a nutshell, and I'm a proud Newark resident again, and thank you for having this important conversation.
Yes, sir, absolutely. And Mr. Frank Smallwood.
Thank you. My name is Frank Smallwood. Thank you again, Mr. Sawab, for inviting us to this discussion. I'm a lifelong Newark resident, graduating from Arts High School on to Union County College. I've had an extensive career in the city of Newark, working with previous administrations. I've had extensive experience in the port community for the past 8 years. And I'm just excited to be a part of the conversation.
Beautiful, beautiful. Now, we had one of the most powerful demonstrations this past week, as like we had back in the early 60s, 70s, and 80s, a movement that will go down in history with Port Newark. And we only wanted to bring about 200 people, but about 500 people showed up. So it was a success. And people out there and Political Viewz audience need to know that the key to recovering from the 67 riots and everything that happened in Newark, New Jersey is geared towards employment, jobs, and training. And the seaport is international, one of the third largest seaports in the world, folks. This is very important, and these two brothers here channeled that so excellently. I can say that everyone that I come across is asking me, wow, y'all did a fantastic job at the park, at the port. Now, together, Alturrick Kenney and Mr. Frank Smallwood, they deserve all the accolades. Mayor Baraka led the way, and their vision is going to bring people that actually live in Newark, you know, jobs at the seaport. Nobody that lives in the city of Newark should be without employment, because we have a seaport, we have an airport. You shouldn't have to go to work outside of your city because there's so much commerce in the city of Newark. So let's expound on that a little bit.
Yeah.
Alturrick, a little more.
Sure. So I think, Swabi, it would be remiss for me not to also include Arnita Green, who did a yeoman's job getting applications processed and put into our database. Also, Street Doctor, who went door to door, neighborhood to neighborhood, making sure information was in the hands of Newark residents.
Okay, shout out to the Street Doctor.
So those two individuals.
And Arnita Green.
Rachma Muhammad. Of course, you can't forget Mayor Baraz Baraka, because 3 weeks ago he put this vision out and said, called us in the office, myself, Frank Smallwood, Dave Muhammad, Rachma Muhammad, and also Street Doctor, and said, we need to do a protest at the port. And the reason why you want to do the protest is at the port, because we've been reaching out to the port ever since we've got in office about residents getting jobs.
Almost 2 years now.
And almost 2 years. Not even two, almost 2 years.
Yeah.
And since that time frame, we've had Newark residents apply. Some didn't get a response. Some waiting for a response. And so we've been playing the game where we want to talk with them and have cordial conversation. And sometimes, cordial conversation has to lead to direct action. And that's kind of what the mayor wanted us to do, is have a direct action regarding some of the things that are happening at the port, to make sure that we directly have a conversation with them. And so we've been talking with New York Shipping Association, International Longman Association, specifically 1233, and the Waterfront Commission. And so the mayor put this vision out. 600 people responded to that vision, and within a matter of a few weeks. And not only that did they respond, you also have community organizations that participated. IYO was one, Youth Build. We had Ryan Hager from New Jersey Social Action Social Justice Institute. So you had a number of organizations that participate. Nation of Islam was also helping us provide just some security along with our Newark Police Department. So a number of institutions participated in this rally because they realized themselves enough is enough. They realized that the port is the third largest port in the country. It's in the top 20 in the entire world.
Right.
And amongst Newark and also Elizabeth, which is the bordering port along with the city of Newark, you have 400,000 residents that live amongst those two cities.
Wow.
And amongst those 400,000 residents that live amongst those two cities, 77% are Hispanic and African American. So without even going in much in depth about the numbers, I want Frank to also share his analysis. Okay. But the numbers didn't reflect, the current employee numbers didn't reflect the demographics at the port. So I know Frank has more information about what we've been trying to accomplish as well.
Okay.
Yes, this has been an ongoing struggle for us. Like Tariq says, we were trying to be politically correct and do the right thing in terms of bringing people, stakeholders to the table to have constructive discourse regarding the activities at the port, the opportunities at the port. This has fallen on deaf ears at different points in time. There's been a lot of just posturing. So it's beautiful to see that the mayor had that kind of vision, and he basically is saying enough is enough. We're trying and trying and trying, and we're not getting where we need to go in terms of employability.
Exactly. So that's why this rally was very important. And a lot of people that live in the city of Newark, people come to our employment office of employment and training all the time and ask for jobs at the seaport and what are, the steps that they have to take to get there. Well, one of them is to get a TWIC card. That's basically like your driver's license. That's your first step, getting your TWIC card, because you can't even get in the seaport or the airport working there without your TWIC card and everything else that goes with it. These two gentlemen are experts in that field.
Hey, Swallow, let me add some context to what you're sharing. So the people since we've been working with the port, 208 people utilize the office to try to find work at the port, whether it's the deep sea side or whether it's the manufacturer side. So we have a number of people who went through the process, submitted an application with New York Shipping Association, submitted an application to the Waterfront Commission, And those individuals have been screened, did the fingerprint, and they made investments. So when you talked about TwitCart, TwitCart is not a small investment. That's $139 out of someone's pocket. Then you do fingerprinting. That's another $38. And then you have your background screened, determine whether you qualify or not qualify for the port. So many of these residents went through the process more than anyone else. And so I know, if Frank, correct me if I'm wrong, about 17 of those residents received the temporary workers pass in last year during the during the summertime.
Yes, for the deep sea side.
Deep sea side. So 17 of those individuals received a waterfront commission card and a temporary worker pass because there were some cruise line ships that needed to be relieved. And so the governors of both states as well as the mayor has pushed and said, well, you have a number of people who have not only the TWIC cards, but you have waterfront passes. Let these guys go in first and help relieve these ships. And so 17 people from our office came through our program were able to work on the cruise line ships and hoping that they would transition from temporary to permanent
full
work.
Time.
And so what we found, you know, in January hit, those temporary passes were asked to be returned because those individuals were never made permanent. So, you know, having that sort of frustration come into your office, you see people who did the right thing, who want to continue to do the right thing. They're not getting those sort of opportunities.
Yeah, that's a travesty in itself. You know, the port is basically monopolized right now. 95% of the port are Caucasians. You don't have African Americans or Hispanics or even Asian folks that are down at the port. And this has been happening and in process for over 50 years. So we're trying to break that cycle so people of color could get their just due. They want to take care of their families, you know, send their children to college. And working at the seaport is a fantastic job for people to be able to get their family to that next step, you know, and provide them with the necessities that they need, better than a living wage. And I would like to ask you guys, Mr. Smallwood, the average salary for someone that works at the port is what?
It's approximately $150,000. That's if you're not really aggressive. If you're aggressive and the way that you earn wealth at the port is by hours. You have to put the hours in. If you put in a lot of hours, you get the largest salary. But you can just have a marginal investment of time and still make $100,000.
Wow.
And I also want to share that to the rank and file people who do work in the port, you guys have a tremendous, you know, responsibility and job. Like, we applaud you for putting the work, putting the effort in. And there's a number of Newark residents that want to join you. And there's a number of women, you know, that want to join you. There's a number of Hispanics and Asians that want to join you. But some reason they find themselves hitting that glass ceiling. And that's kind of what the mayor is talking about, is that how do we get beyond that glass ceiling to get actual work? And Mr. Swab, do you mind if I just share some numbers?
Oh, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay. Absolutely.
So when we started working in this office, we were getting numbers from the Waterfront Commission to New York Shipping Association. And we actually did some outreach to Daggert's office, who is the president of the International Longman Association. Unfortunately, he never responded to our letters and our calls. But we found out that the of the 3,299 longshoremen at the time in 2013 that were working at the port, 2,997 were male, 302 were female. Of that 3,299 longshoremen, 2,055 were white. I want to say this one more time because I think it should capture what we're talking about.
Yes, sir, absolutely.
Out of 3,299 people who serve as longshoremen, 2,055 are white, 787 are black, 510 are Hispanic, 17 Asian, and 13 are others. And for the city of Newark specifically, because that's why we're here today also,
yes, sir,
is that out of the city of Newark, the port that sits in the city of Newark consists of about 20% of all work that happens out of that port. Only 6.3%, which is 209 people, actually were Newark residents. So out of 3,299 people, only 209 people are Newark residents. And there's been some conversation where you have the president of the union and some other people say, well, And there was a letter that he put out in response to our letter to Secretary Perez that said, well, people got these middle class longshoremen jobs. They sought other opportunities and decided to move. And that's, we happy. This America, if anybody chooses to relocate their families to anywhere, God bless them and their families. But we're under the speculation that we know that more than 6.9% of the people that live in this area should be working in the city of Newark, should be Newark residents. And we think those numbers are extremely low, you know, for a port that sit right here in the city of Newark.
Yeah, they are. That's a travesty, I believe, in itself. Out of almost 3,000 people, it's only 209 people that work at the port that actually live in the city of Newark. This is a matter that needs to be addressed, not just today on Political Viewz, GS Radio Newark. This needs to be addressed everywhere, you know, because people of color have been given, putting in the back seat, I would say, like in the 60s, in the buses with Rosa Parks, you know, we were always treated as second-class citizens. And it seems like this is what's happening at the seaport now. They're treating people of color as second-class citizens, like we're not qualified to go and work in the seaport, though we are.
So additionally to that, there's a culture in the port that separate but equal. They have a Jim Crow kind of a dynamic. They have two separate unions, one black union, one white union, which is in 2016 the most lucrative, most insane thing that I've heard. It's the most ludicrous, you know.
Yeah.
So it's like just a culture, and then the buy-in from the people inside of it to say that that's okay as long as I'm making X amount of dollars, it's all right that we have this impropriety going on internally.
Yeah, this Jim Crow.
Exactly.
Jim Crow was horrible.
And so that's why we're here. And so I also want to add something else as well. So you have the longshore side, and you also had checker side. So the checkers, to give you a little bit more context as well, is that in 2013, we also found that the checkers are one of the higher paid positions, salary positions in the city, in this area. And it's a blue-collar job. In the checkers union, 87% at the time of 663 active registers, 87% were white.
Wow.
And 5.3% black, 7.4% Hispanic, and Asians a 0.15%. Didn't even make it to one yet.
Wow.
So, and then out of that checker position, 86.6 are male and 13% are female. So what we're saying is that in the checker position, which is pretty much, I wouldn't say it's an easy job. It's not as labor-intensive job. It doesn't require a lot of lifting and a lot of carrying. Those are some of the ideal positions. And unfortunately, women and also minorities haven't found themselves busting through that glass ceiling that we discussed earlier. And even if you look at the income disparities, you have white checkers on average make about $153,000. Hispanic, $147,000. Interesting to note. Blacks, $140,000. That's about 8.2% less than whites. And of course, Asians, who are pushing up the rear, are making about $98,000 in salary. You know, so just show you the disparity that was surfaced in 2013 when the last contract year occurred. And so that's the reason why the port was mandated by courts as a result of a fight through the Waterfront Commission and the ILA and also NYSA, to become more integrated, to employ people more locally, because based on the hiring practices of the past, they felt that they need to bring more minorities inside the fold.
Absolutely.
Absolutely, and that's the reason why so many African Americans, and you had, you know, people all over the country say, well, you know, I don't see why affirmative action should work, you know, people of color, you know, you guys are getting your fair share. But actually, as you just heard the numbers from Alturrick Kenney, that we're not getting our fair share. And this is some 50, 60 years later. You know, we're still considered second class citizens. And then the Constitution says that we were supposed to get 40 acres in a mule, never received. So the wealth wasn't equal here. And I always have people, you know, reach out to me, say, well, the African-Americans here, you know, they lazy. They just don't want to work. But let me tell you something. The African-Americans in this country built this country off the backs, not just United States of America, Portugal, Great Britain, France, and all these other countries shared the wealth off the backs of African-American people. Not 100 years, not 200 years, over 500 years. So we are a people that will work, right? We're not lazy. We're educated, and we should be treated as equals in 2016 with a black president, Barack Obama and Michelle. Shout out to them. And it's just a shame that in 2016, we still have to fight the good fight, but we're ready, and we don't take a backseat to not anyone. African Americans in this country are very important. We are pivotal to the economy here, and we spend our dollars just like the wealth of other countries. So the African Americans here in the United States of America are to be counted. We are proud people. We love our community, even though things are happening. And, you know, political views, I always say this is a positive show. We hear so much negativity, but on this show, it's about positivity and moving people forward, right? And let me get your outlook on that, Mr. Smallwood.
Additionally, it's the culture that's in place is set to wherein, oh, there's jobs that's already that we know are available. That's part of what this fight is. We know the jobs are available. We know the jobs are available on the Checkers side. We know the jobs are available in the ILA. And they hold jobs specifically for whomever they want to hold them for. That's the major problem. You know, we know that we have people ready with all the qualifications, with the TWIC cards, clearing waterfront commission, and still not being considered. That's the major part of the fight. That's why enough is enough with that.
Yeah, enough is enough. We have to keep up the good fight. Kudos to Mayor Baraka and Amiri Baraka Jr., you know, chief of staff. And they always put the focus on Norkers, right? And that's very important, as well as me and these brothers here. You know, we want people in the city of Newark to work, and having people work will reduce crime in the city of Newark.
And Mr. Swab, you actually made a great point about income, and I wanted to touch on what you shared. In 2018, the projected number that African Americans will have in their personal income is about $1.3 trillion. And so when you stagnate the income of a people, you also impact their families, you impact their neighborhoods, you impact their ability for their children to grow up in the sort of neighborhoods that we all want our children to grow up, where they have access and opportunities that we might not have had the same sort of access. And so with these deep sea jobs that we talked about with the longshoremen side, so these are the highest paid blue collar positions in the region. And so only thing we're saying is that we have people who have skills, right? You have skills, they have credentials, they have TWIC cards, they have able bodies and hands, they have the will. And so only thing they're asking for is, I want an opportunity to even interview, right? But not to even give them an interview, to even demonstrate their capabilities. It's a shame. The biggest shame also is that because the income inequality that happens in not only in this country, but also in this region, is that those families who are locked out of the opportunities to move themselves from where they are into very stable, middle-class jobs, you also impacted the city of Newark directly. So you have families who quite naturally will live in the city of Newark because that's where they work, or just because they just want to stay in the city of Newark because that's where they want to raise their families. You're stopping off, you're cutting off a lifeline that can help them and their families and help their children. And that's why this fight is important, not only to the city of Newark, but it should be important for anybody
country.
who's sick and tired of injustices.
Sure.
You're absolutely right, and sick and tired of injustices that not only happen throughout the world, but also in this country, but also in this region. I mean, we're not talking about people with hoods anymore, right? We're talking about people with suits and ties who can intellectually tell you that African Americans and Hispanics are not intellectually smart enough or capable enough to become checkers. Like, that's just crazy. Like, even in the last hiring part, right? So even when they did the last change of how they're going to include more minorities inside the process, 150 checkers were recently hired. Out of those 150 checkers that were hired, 120 were white. So what they're really saying is this. They're saying that if you are white, you are more capable, mm-hmm. you're smarter than, because I remember David Sicilese was the president of the union, said to me, he said that the checkers are the brains of the union, the brains of the port. Well, if they're the brains of the port, and at 85% of all the new hires, what does that say about us? What does it say about African Americans? What does it say about even just getting a chance to get employed in that particular position?
So this is racism, you know, so, at its worst.
So racism doesn't have to be a hood, right? A racism doesn't have to be a person telling you you're the N-word. Racism is denying opportunity. Racism is starving your family. Racism is also limiting the amount of income that you have for you and your family and the options you have for your children. You know, so that's racism.
Institutional racism. It absolutely is.
And it's also being passed down from generation to generation. So somehow reason, our Irish and Italian brothers have forgotten how they got inside these opportunities themselves. And these sort of folks are primarily in leadership in these unions. And sometimes they forgot that it was through struggle, through fight, and through opportunity that they were able to ascend through middle class opportunities. Well, we want the same sort of, you know, opportunities as well. And we're supposed to be fighting together as brothers, right, not looking at each other as enemies. And that's kind of the way we should be having this conversation.
Exactly, because we live under one umbrella. And when it rains, we all get under the umbrella. Whether you're black, you're white, you're Asian, Hispanic, African, whatever. And it's just institutionalized racism to keep African American peoples out of any job. As Martin Luther King said, is an injustice anywhere is not justice for everyone everywhere. And that rings true today, and it's a shame that these things are happening, and that's why it's so important for Newarkers to come out and be part of the change that's happening with this Barack administration. Has never been done before. In the last 50 years, Occupy the Port was a success, and we put something in the eyes of the whole country and world that we're standing up, we stand in solidarity, we're together. Our unity is tantamount to everything that we want to see in the city of Newark, and we want our citizens to be counted.
And so I want to also add, you know, the hard work that Frank has done, because not only is Frank has been here working with the mayor, but also he predates the mayor. And so there's a number of things that Frank has done over the years regarding trying to get people inside the port on the maintenance side in the warehouse. So, I mean, I know he has some numbers that he wants to shoot to you, but to talk about, you know, some of the struggles that you faced, you know, working in that industry as well.
Absolutely. The report as it relates to the warehouse, the maintenance side, is 265 maintenance workers. I'm sorry, of the 265 maintenance workers, there were a total of, I'm sorry, the report also indicates 265, 11.9% of 2,229 total registered warehouse maintenance workers have Newark addresses, which is a very low percentage. Of the 2,200 warehouse workers, there were 82 males and 145 females, 41%, and the white population is 94%. So it's just, you know, just a crazy number the way that.
So,
you know,
and women not even counted inside the seaport, really, as we see the numbers that these gentlemen has given us on Political Viewz today. Well, we say black women are strong. We love you. Shout out to my tech, the beautiful Tanya Champagne, black woman on her grind, on the move.
Happy Mother's Day,
respectful. Happy Mother's Day to all the women out there in the Political Viewz audience. You have fun. This is your day, and we support the black woman 1,010,000%.
And when a black man's working, the black family's happy.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
And a happy home. Yeah.
Totally.
A happy home is always good.
Yeah. So that was my militant talk, but when the family is, everyone in the family is working, the family is happy. So
family is happy.
Happy Mother's Day to everyone.
Definitely Happy Mother's Day.
Yeah, Happy Mother's Day. And I tell folks, when I grew up, we didn't have the situations that are going on today. You know, African-American folks, black folks in the late 60s, early 70s loved each other more. We was a community, that village that you always hear about. You know, if my mom had to work late, maybe I'm spending the night over Alturrick Kenney house, if he my next door neighbor, until my mom came home. Our community was so different than what's happening today. You know, it's a divide and conquer type of thing. But in the 70s, 80s, and even 90s, we treated our community better. You know,
yeah,
and
let's have that talk right now. Like, yeah. I know. So some of the things that I know I've witnessed Sawab do, because I know this brother is a humble guy. He actually works with a population, the people who are the most difficult, well, perceived to be the most difficult to manage and also to inspire. So like Sawab, like I know you interviewing us, but what keeps you motivated and strong to not only provide quality service to our people, but also have the fortitude to look beyond whatever faults they walk into your doors with and still provide them high quality services?
Well, see, just, you know, my title at, you know, for the Barack administration, operational manager, you have to be humble. I'm a person with humility. So I want to see, you know, people that look like me, you know, progress, even though they may be coming, you know, from all type walks of life that come through our office. But you have to keep yourself humble and remain positive, because I channeled my experiences to the 70s and the 60s, even in the 1920s, how through life our struggles has been since the days of slavery. So when I look at people who look like me coming in, I'm doing everything that I can to help them get to that next level, you know, which is most needed. And I don't have a problem with doing overtime, even though I might not get paid for overtime. But I want to see folks like me work. I want our community to be like the days of Imhotep in Egypt. You know, we are the mathematicians for the world. You don't hear this stuff. We had the sewer system in Egypt, and that tells of the whole diaspora, not just in Africa, all over the world. We touch everyone. All the greatest inventors of all time happened to be African American. We invented the air conditioner, right? The lights that we're using now. Louis A. Latimer would work with Thomas Edison. Thomas Edison field core kept blowing out. So Louis A. Latimer worked with him and created the coil that make the light bulb last a little longer. This is magnificent. Not just that, we're not included in the whole spectrum of what our community has done, not just for America, for the entire world.
I have to also attest to it that Mr. Sawab is a very positive influence and a pleasure to work with. I work hand in hand with him.
Yes,
and
sir.
He's always inspired and always giving back to folks. So we work very well together, and
absolutely,
we just try to get it done.
And you can't make this stuff up, folks. Once you just have to care about people. And we have all walks of life coming through our office, people who are hurting, people who don't have jobs, who might not have had the education that I have. You know, when I was growing up, my mom didn't have to tell me, well, you better go to school and get good grades. I wanted to do that. Straight A student in the 70s, the 80s. I listened to my parents. Anything they told me, I said, yes, ma'am. No, ma'am. Yes, sir. No, sir. Any adult could ask me to do anything. Young fella, grab that for me right there. Yes, sir. Immediately. That's the type of era that I grew up in. The days of Muhammad Ali, Malcolm X, just to name a few, Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And it was so much discipline growing up in the 70s and 80s in the city of Newark. Newark was a thriving and clean city.
Yeah. I mean, I think there's some not only truth to that, but I think there's some, we're trying to get back to that.
Absolutely.
And I think that part of what our mission is, you know, working in the offices that we work in, is to provide hope for people who feel
who don't have hope.
Absolutely.
Right?
That's true.
So when they walk into your office, they walk in not with their hands out begging, they walk in with their hands out looking for help. And that's our responsibilities and the roles that we have, is to make sure that whatever we give them honest service. And so, you know, one of the things that the mayor has made us do in our port office is provide them honest service and go out and get jobs for Newark residents. Mm-hmm. You know, so I say go out. Not only do you find them when they walk into your facility, but you also go to the prisons and talk with them there.
Absolutely.
You know? And so there's no borders to the work that we do.
Absolutely.
You know, there's no borders to the services that people are need in terms of provide. So, for example, like this whole idea of occupy the block. Think about how revolutionary that is.
Yeah.
Is that we're not saying that your job stops after 5 o'clock, because I know you said we don't get paid for overtime, but you're always on time, right?
So exactly.
There's no OT, overtime,
exactly.
But it's always on time, right?
On time.
So when somebody walked up to you at one of the occupy the block initiatives, you were on time for them. You know, so that
Absolutely.
Conversation, you know, build into, well, let me try out Newark Works, because I've heard some things in the past about it, about people using the services but not getting an opportunity. And so when you actually engage them where they are, talk with them, encourage them, have that small conversation with them could lead to a change for them for the rest of their lives and also for their families. So, like, I know a number of times when I met people, I said, well, what brings you to our office? Well, I talked to Swab today, you know, he saw me at, so-and-so street, and
right.
I'm looking for work. And, you know, from that conversation, our responsibility is to continue to provide them honest service, provide them hope, provide them training if they need it, provide them jobs if we can find it. And if we can't find them jobs, not because of their skills, but because people are locking themselves out of it, then we need to make sure we open those doors up.
Exactly.
We need to make sure we take 500 people with us and go down.
Exactly.
To the pool.
Right.
We need to fill 600 applications and submit them.
And then keep that number increasing. It might
keep
go up to
exactly.
2,000, you know, 5,000 people.
Yep.
Whatever we need to do to knock those hinges off the doors,
okay.
We need to do that.
And that's why your audience is so important, because we need allies, right? It can't just be Mayor Baraka. It can't be Ali Sawab. It can't be Frank Small, Alturrick, Rockmai. It can't be those small group of people, and Arnita Green, even Mildred Crump. It can't be a small group of people who are involved in politics because they either work in politics or they happen to be elected officials. It has to be everyday or regular people.
Regular
who say,
folks.
Listen, I may be a regular person, but the task that you guys are taking on is Herculean, that I believe that Newark residents should have jobs. People should actually have the opportunity to work where they live. That's kind of what we're advocating for. Think about this for a second, Sawab. 18% of Newark residents who actually work in the city that they live in. Like, not because they don't have the skills, but because they're just not given the opportunity. And
that's a travesty.
One of the most ridiculous statistics that you can actually give. 18% of Newark residents actually work in a city where they live.
Right.
And so that's kind of what we need to stop, because our city swells to almost a million people between the hours of 8 o'clock until 5 o'clock in the evening.
Every
right?
day, folks.
And it becomes a highway in and a highway out, right?
Yeah.
But the question becomes, where the
what's
new
left?
Residents?
Yeah, and what's
know,
left?
Exactly, what's left? Once
sure.
you abandon
it's like
people,
we're invisible.
Yeah, and so we got to make sure that no one looks over us anymore. This ain't an invisible man anymore.
Exactly.
Right? I don't have a cloaking system on. You're going to see me. You're going to hear me. You're going to feel me.
Yeah.
And so that's why what you do, Sawab, and what you do, Frank, well, what we do, is so critically important. But I think what's even more critically important is having a leadership like Mayor Baraka, who's just not only a mayor, but is also a principal and an activist, to make sure that we go out into the neighborhoods and find the people where they are.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. And on that note, we'll be taking a break, and we'll be taking a few calls. GS Radio North, if you want to speak with Alturrick Kenney or Mr. Frank Smallwood. 973-901-9646, GS Radio North.
change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die.
Welcome back to Political Viewz with Ali Sawab, with my special guest, the intellectual Alturrick Kenney, and the intellectual Mr. Frank Smallwood, part of the Barack administration, as well as myself. And we're going to continue the conversation just about, you know, what's going on in Essex County as a whole. And our Occupy the Port was a success. And we're going to follow up and make sure the people of this city, black and brown, Asian, get their fair share, as well as our women. So, welcome back, guys.
Again, thank you for the conversation. And like we said earlier in the last segment, that it's important to have this conversation because these conversations have been having behind closed doors. These conversations have not been having because people put their political future behind unions that don't do right by us. And this is, again, this is not an attack on unions. This is an attack on people who support injustice.
And very important.
So if it doesn't apply to you, you know, don't fight it. You know, if it doesn't apply, don't fight. And so that's why this is important. And 500, 600 people showed up at the port and said the same exact thing. So it was great to know that we're not alone. And it was people who came after us, after the protest, and said, well, we didn't know you guys were protesting. We'll support the next one. You know, and we actually have some of our white brethren from out of Staten Island who said, listen, we have a port right in our own community. We can't find work.
Wow.
And so it's bigger than just a Newark issue. I mean, if think about this for a second, Sawab and Frank. If all the cities throughout the entire country made the same sort of protest that we made, maybe if we just decided to take one day, right, Charlotte, Baltimore, Miami, if their families are not finding work at the port where they live, and they say, you know what, we're going to protest the port at the same time, that would be a big statement, right?
Yes,
Newark,
sir.
Newark, Elizabeth, Baltimore, Los Angeles, Brooklyn, and those folks are saying the same things we're saying. The port is right there. I see a water, I see a ship, and I see containers. Why can't I work on that port? And so if we all said at one time, listen, you know, we're going to protest and shut all the ports down because we realize they're not doing great by local hiring, I think that would make a large statement.
Yeah, globally.
Globally, right?
Because we have services from all type of companies from all over the world. Mm-hmm.
I think it's also additionally, people are asking us, well, what's next? That was great, but what are we looking to accomplish? What's the takeaway? And of course, we can't predict the future, but there's things about it that we've raised the stakes.
We've raised the stakes of the bar, as they say.
Exactly, and the major thing of it is we have some leverage in terms of being the landlord for the port. There's things that we can leverage in that conversation.
Newark land, people. That means the city of Newark owns the port.
Additionally,
the land.
And the major thing is that we have great leadership in our Honorable Mayor Raz Baraka.
Yeah, Honorable Mayor Raz Baraka.
So whatever it is that he deems necessary going forward, we're 100%
we're going
behind.
To do. So, you
and,
know.
And so the practical steps that Frank talked about, and he touched on slightly, is that what do we do next? So the applications that people submitted, those individuals will be reached out to complete their applications. We'll submit those applications to the New York Shipping Association. We're also going to submit an Excel sheet to the Waterfront Commission to let people know these are the individuals that we submit applications on behalf of for those opportunities. We also have folks who submit applications prior to this March. Their applications will go in as well. So I remember one of the things that came up through this protest is that 97 people actually had the applications move forward to the Waterfront Commission, which simply means is that it's just like getting a license, right? If the ILA, the New York Shipping Association, approves you for the first round, they'll take your application and move you towards the Waterfront Commission. Now, out of 1,367 people that applied and got interviewed, only 97 people were Newark residents that was moved to the front of the the New York Shipping Association and the Waterfront Commission. And so we're saying is that we know more than 97 people, right? We know about 800 people who were interested in those jobs, right? And so when a gang relief system decides, when they submit the application for a gang relief system, which means about 200 new jobs that'll come on board, we have about 800 people in our database that they can screen from. And they can look through all those 800 applications and figure out all 200 that they want to hire if they decide to hire that route. And if they can't find, you know, the 800, we'll put another call out. We'll get Street Doctor out. We'll get Arnita out.
You'll
we'll get
Mr. Sawab out.
You know, get Sawab out. You know, get just troops out. And we'll make sure that the information goes out because at the end of the day, it's their port. It belongs to them. Absolutely. And they should have an opportunity to know that there's an opening.
And
they're looking for bodies. And there's an opportunity that exists for them.
Exactly. And our brothers in solidarity and last night with Mayor Stephen Fullup out of Jersey City. We support him. Mayor Baraka had him come to, you know, the city of Newark just in a solidarity type of thing. You know, the move Newark forward and continue in partnership with other cities like Patterson, Mayor Torres, you know, Plainfield, East Orange, Irvington, Tony Voss, and just a spectrum of mayors from around the surrounding areas in solidarity, because instead of spending our revenue with other folks, the person next door that's close to you is even more better.
Yeah. Yeah, you especially know, they have the, they know your pains because their pains are the same.
Exactly.
As
ours. Yeah. Exactly.
You know, whatever happens in Newark also happens, impacts Jersey City and impacts Patterson. We're all interconnected. So once we have those sort of conversations, whether it's support, whether it's the school system, you know,
whether it's corporations. Know,
corporations who want to invest or disinvest in urban communities, we all connected. And people just want opportunities. And they want opportunities to everything that every American has access to. To put their families in a position that they're successful, to get a job where they live, to have the great access to education, highways that they talk about in this country. They want access to clean water, clean parks, you know, things that they find
good
difficult
schools
to have in Flint, Michigan,
yeah,
and also in North Public Schools,
yeah,
in 30 schools. Right. You know, so those are real things that people want. Like, and so we're not seeing that on a scale that we should see it on, and that's why this port is one of many initiatives that we have to rally behind to get people justice.
Yeah. African Americans need to be counted.
Yeah.
Right? That's number one.
And also African Americans ain't doing this alone.
Oh, yeah. It's
we
Hispanic
can't be by
brothers.
Ourselves. They got to be
we
with us.
We want our Asian brothers and sisters, and we want our women.
Mm.
Right? Because a lot of women, you know, are not second-class citizens. Like, they view African Americans. The African American man and woman, and our Asian brothers and sisters, and Hispanics, and some of our Caucasian brothers and sisters that are not counted, like you said, in Staten Island at Dayport, they can't find work. This is ludicrous. You know, the 1%, the people in this country that are rich and wealthy, need to share the wealth, right? Need to share the wealth, because when one person keeps all the wealth, then everything eventually falls. Because if people just one day said, well, no one is going to do any type of jobs until everyone eats, that's what's needed in the United States of America. All over, we have people in urban areas that are hurting, you know, just want work and want that better life, like Alturrick Kenney said, you know, to take care of their family and be a viable source to their community.
Yeah, and I also want, like I said, we opened up, and I'm gonna point to the camera. Longshoremen, to rank and file, we do not want to take a job from you. We do not want your bonuses that you receive at the end of the year. We think it's a healthy bonus, is able to provide for you and your family. We understand that. The only thing that we want you to do is support what we're doing, is to make sure we're able to bring in new residents who are able to work alongside of you as the port expands, as the Bayonne Bridge increases in height, as bigger ships come into our territory. We need to prepare residents for those opportunities. So this is not a situation where we want to take jobs from you. There's going to be jobs there anyway, right? And so only thing we're asking is that you support what we're doing. We want Newark residents working. And we need you to actually be more vocal in your union halls. We know you have other responsibilities in terms of, you know, a very dangerous work that you're a part of. And we respect it and honor it. In fact, because we need you to be at those ports, because that's how we get imports and export in and out of this country. But in addition to that, this is not a fight against you at all. This is the fight for Newark residents to get jobs. This is to people who do the hiring. And some of you have gotten those opportunities because, in honesty, some of you may be related to some people, or some of you probably just came in the second or third year because other people have fought for you to get those positions. And
like
so,
us.
Like us. And there's going to be people who are who need you to help support us. So this is not a fight against you at all. We ask you for your support because Newark residents, Elizabeth residents, this region needs to work.
Yeah, absolutely. Essex County as a whole, and all minorities. Whether it be Asian, blacks, you know, Spanish, you know. And we want to leave with closing words. I'd like to get Mr. Frank Smallwood. Give me your closing words. Then we'll go to Brother Alturrick Kenney, and I'll be giving the final closing.
Great. I just appreciate the opportunity to come and address your viewing audience and address the issues regarding the port and port activity. We look forward to doing more to expand our operations and our horizons toward what we're doing going forward. And we'll definitely want to keep you abreast on it.
Yes, sir. And I will have you brothers back as well to do, you know, a follow-up show.
We're here. And so my final thoughts are this. Out of 365 maintenance folks who work in the port, 0% are Asian, 1.6 are Black, 12.6 are Hispanic, and 85% are white. Out of our checkers union, 684 work. 87% of those 684 people are white, 7.2% are Hispanic, 5.5% are Black. And so the numbers speak for themselves. We're not trying to make up numbers, trying to create a fight where it doesn't exist. We think that an injustice here is injustice everywhere.
Everywhere.
And so we need you to support what we're doing. Again, we just happen to be the people who are fighting this fight. But for families unbeknownst to us right now, for children that's unborn right now, they will be the beneficiaries of the fight that we put down for ourselves today. And if we ignore ourselves because of self-gratification or self-interest, it's an injustice to the names that we call to speak justice into power. So we need you to support. And when we put the call out for 5,000 people, we need you to be there and ready to go. We also need you to continue providing us qualified candidates who have an opportunity to work at the port. But also, if you're an employer, you know, this is a commercial. Please come to Newark Works. We need jobs. So if you're an employer, we want to hire Newark residents. So we have qualified people that we all three of us see on a day-to-day basis who say, I want to find a job where I live, and I want to find a job to provide for my family. All sorts of people come into our office, from entry level to professional, from attorneys to people who just came home either from Iraq or came home from Norway.
Different war.
Exactly, yeah. From a different war. So we have jobs. We have qualified people. So please come and use Newark Works. We need you to help us provide jobs for Newark residents.
1008 Broad Street.
1008 Broad Street.
And my closing thoughts would be, thanks for coming out, brothers Frank Smallwood and brother Alturrick Kenney. Always a pleasure, and I call brother Alturrick Kenney my young professor because he's smart as knuckles. And Mr. Frank Smallwood, I call him the older gentleman or the older guy. I'm the young guy, you know. And
YG and OG.
These brothers are so, you know, on a grind. And we support each other. See, we like this for real. We laugh, we joke, you know, we shed tears in the inside, you know, for our residents and people who live in the city of Newark so much. This is how it is for real, people. This is real talk. And I would like to say that each one reach one, teach one, right? We must do this. And we kudos to Mayor Baraka, and rest in peace to Mary Baraka Sr. And all the mothers that are out there. Happy Mother's Day to you in advance. And as I say, God or Allah has all the glory. When you see people going left in your life, you go right and keep the focus on you, and you will be a better person. Tune in next week to Political Viewz with my beautiful partner, Ms. Tanya Champagne. And Political Viewz is produced by TNS Entertainment Group, LLC.
Love you, BK. I'm sorry.
All right, folks. Thanks for tuning in to Political Viewz with Ali Sawab. Always a pleasure. We out.
Well, I have to give my daughter a shout out. Daddy. Look, you sit there for hours. We'll be right back.
that private dick, that's a sex machine to all the chicks. You're damn right. Ooh, there's a man that will risk his neck for his brother, man. Can you dig it? Who's the cat that won't come out when they'll tell you all about? Right on. They say this cat Shaft is a bad mother. I'm talking about Shaft. He's a complicated man, but no one understands him but